The Bible. The Bible studies on these tapes are either sermons or radio broadcasts by Pastor Sheldon Emery. We pray they will be a blessing to you and to all who may hear. For a current list of recorded sermons and radio broadcasts, and a list of printed literature, write to America's Promise, Box 5334, Phoenix, Arizona.
The Burning Hell, Truth or Blasphemy? In the Old and New Testament, the words blaspheme or blasphemy come from a Hebrew or Greek word which means to vilify God or evil speaking against God, to defame a person, and in some places it's used in relation to people rather than God. And this is all from Strong's Concordance, or to bring scorn upon God or to libel a person. In other words, to tell lies about someone is to blaspheme them. And you can do this to individuals or to God. Because of the fact we have so many new listeners to Kingdom Identity Truths, many of them have not heard some of the other doctrines of the churches examined in the light of the Bible. So that's what we're going to do with the doctrine of the churches in relation to the burning hell. I'll state the doctrine just briefly, and then I'll be reading some things from various church sources in which they describe their burning hell. Generally speaking, the Catholic Church and most of the Protestant denominations are pretty well agreed on what hell is. And they generally teach, and as I say, I'm not specific as far as denominations are concerned, this is general. They generally teach that the human beings who die continue to live in some sort of a spirit form, and they go either to one place or another. The one place being what they call hell, where there are devils and demons and fire and torture and pain, and that person stays there alive for all eternity, suffering what they call the tortures of the damned or the tortures of the unsaved. On the other hand, those who believe, according to their doctrine, in the God they teach or preach, will go to another place which they call heaven, where they will enjoy an eternity of bliss, and they'll be in the presence of God there instead of the presence of devils and so on. Now, there are various things which they preach in conjunction with that, but generally speaking, that is the ultimate destiny of all mankind according to the Catholic Church and almost all of what we call Protestantism in the world today. Let's start this examination by turning to the Psalms and reading a few things about God Himself, because it is God of whom we are speaking in relation to the ultimate destiny of man. In Psalm 25, starting in verse 4, I read this: Show me thy ways, O Lord, teach me thy paths, lead me in thy truth, and teach me. For thou art the God of my salvation, on thee do I wait all the day. Remember, O Lord, thy tender mercies and thy loving kindness, for they have been ever of old. Remember not the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions. According to thy mercy, remember thou me for thy goodness' sake, O Lord. Psalm 33, starting in verse 1, Rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous, for praise is comely for the upright. Praise the Lord with harp, sing unto him with psaltery and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto him a new song, play skillfully with a loud noise. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. He loveth righteousness and judgment. The earth is full of the goodness of the Lord. In Psalm 36, verses 5 through 7, Thy mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens, and thy faithfulness reacheth unto the clouds. Thy righteousness is like the great mountains, thy judgments are a great deep. O Lord, thou preservest man and beast. How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God! Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. Psalm 52, in verse 1, Why boastest thou thyself in mischief, O mighty man? The goodness of God endureth continually. Verse 8, But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the mercy of God forever and ever. And in Psalm 57, verses 9 and 10, I will praise thee, O Lord, among the people. I will sing unto thee among the nations, for thy mercy is great unto the heavens, and thy truth unto the clouds. Now, I could read on for the rest of this time in the Psalms, as you know, to show that one of the great attributes of God is mercy. Mercy, loving kindness, goodness are those virtues of God which are extolled in God's Word from Genesis to Revelation. The Psalms, of course, are full of them, and in the few that we read here, as we saw, the psalmist said in effect that one of the reasons he trusted God, and one of the reasons he called on God, one of the reasons he believed in God, was because of his mercy and his loving kindness. Now, I want to read out of the Noah Webster's dictionary, which was published in the 1800s, his definition of the word blasphemy. I think most of you know the definition of the word truth. Literally, all it means is that which is right in relation to that which is false. But here is the Bible definition of about 100 years ago or a little more on the words blaspheme, blasphemy, and so on. Blaspheme, it says, the first syllable is the same as in blame, denoting injury. Probably, and then he goes into the French and all of the rest of these, and he says it means to hurt. To hurt. If you blaspheme something, you blame it, you hurt it. Then he gives these. To speak of the Supreme Being in terms of impious irreverence, to revile or speak reproachfully of God or the Holy Spirit. And he gives some scripture references. Number two, to speak evil of or to utter abuse, to speak reproachfully of. Blaspheme, to utter blasphemy. And then again he quotes scripture verses as Webster does here, or gives the reference. To arrogate the prerogatives of God. A blasphemer, of course, is one who does this. Blaspheming, blasphemous, impious, irreverent, or reproachful towards God. Blaspheming, an indignity offered to God by words or writing. Reproachful, contemptuous, or irreverent words uttered impiously against Jehovah. And then he quotes a man by the name of Linwood. Blasphemy is an injury offered to God by denying that which is due and belonging to him, or attributing to him that which is not agreeable to his nature. And then he quotes another man a little further, and then he says this. In the Middle Ages, blasphemy was used to denote simply the blaming or condemning of a person or thing. Among the Greeks, to blaspheme was to use words of ill omen, which they were careful to avoid. And then the last one is that which derogates from the prerogatives of God. So blasphemy, just from Webster, would seem to be anything which is untrue and brings a false knowledge about a person or God to other people, something that hurts and that takes away from that person something which rightfully belongs to him. Now, I have a booklet here, and I'll be quoting from this because this is a compilation or a collection of passages from church publications. And these are both Catholic and Protestant, so the man has been very ecumenical, as it were, by quoting these things. And I want to read some of the direct quotes taken from writings of churches on the burning hell. And then we'll get into the scripture after I read some of this. He says on page 26, St. Alphonsus Liguori, that great and illustrious man, the founder of a most admirable religious order, the Redemptoris, the apostle of the ignorant and the poor, speaks of hell as a gloom where light only reveals horror, where the carcasses of the damned lie in heaps, unmoved and unmovable, in torrents of fire, which impenetrate the brains within the head, the marrow within the bones, and the bowels within the body. The sight of sinners will be appalled by the ugliest of demons dancing upon their prey, their smell by a stench compared to which all the evil odors of the earth are jasmine or attagul. St. Liguori goes on to explain the sufferings of the other senses and concludes that the souls of the lost must toss to and fro forever in a fiery deluge like chips upon an ocean, but chips consubstantiated with fire. And then he says on this, on another page, it is indeed probable that religious terrorism played a more important part in the monastic phase of Christianity than it had done even in the great work of the conversion of the pagans. According to the patristic theologians, it was part of the gospel revelation that the misery and suffering the human race endures upon the earth is but a feeble image of that which awaits it in the future world, that all its members beyond the church, as well as a very large proportion of those who are within its pale, are doomed to an eternity of agony in a literal and undying fire. And then he gives pages and pages of quotes on this. Here is one of the direct quotes. We can only say that hell is a living death, an eternal agony. In hell there is no God. I cannot stand putting my finger for more than a moment in the flame of a candle. How then can I bear the eternal fire of hell? All the sufferings I can suppose would end quickly, for I would soon lose the feeling of pain, or I would die. But in hell there is no death. The fire of hell burns but does not kill. It has flames but gives no light. And in that eternal darkness, choked by horrible smells, hearing only curses and fearful cries of souls in agony, I should burn for all eternity if I die in mortal sin. But what is eternity? If once in a million years a bird should come and take away one grain of sand from the earth, now mind you, this is in a church publication, how long it would take to carry away all the earth, yet that time would be nothing compared to eternity. It would hardly be the beginning of eternity, for eternity has no end. It goes on and on forever and forever and ever. And then this gives the information at the bottom of this, that this is in a booklet designed for children's study. In other words, in a school carried on by a church. Turn with me to Deuteronomy 32. This is the first time that the word hell appears in the King James translation. The first time it is in the Bible, and God is speaking to Israel, and this is in the Song of Moses, of course, through Moses. Deuteronomy 32, starting in verse 20. And he said, I will hide my face from them, this is God, I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very froward generation, children in whom is no faith. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, in other words, with their lies. And I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. For a fire is kindled in mine anger, and shall burn into the lowest hell, and shall consume the earth with her increase, and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. And I should think that almost any Baptist would have a question if he ever has read the first time the word hell is in the Holy Bible, because this goes far beyond what the Baptists teach. This says that this fire of hell will consume the earth with her increase. So not only is it going to be burning in hell, apparently this fire kindled by God is going to burn up all of the earth and everything upon it. And that is the first time the word hell is used in the Bible. The next time is in a Song of David in 2 Samuel 22. And we'll start reading in verse 1. And David spake unto the Lord the words of this song in the day that the Lord had delivered him out of the hand of all his enemies and out of the hand of Saul. And he said, The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. The God of my rock, in him will I trust. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my high tower and my refuge, my Savior. Thou savest me from violence. I will call on the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. When the waves of death compassed me, the floods of ungodly men made me afraid, the sorrows of hell compassed me about, the snares of death prevented me. So here it seems as if David suffered or experienced the punishments or the pains of hell while he was yet alive. The next time is the word hell appears is in the 11th chapter of Job, verse 1, Then answered Zophar the Naamathite and said, in other words, this is the other man speaking, and he said, among other things, verses 7 and 8, Canst thou by searching find out God? canst thou find out the Almighty unto perfection? It is as high as heaven, what canst thou do? Deeper than hell, what canst thou know? So whatever hell is, God is deeper than hell is. And then in Psalm 9, in verse 17 we read, and this is a very well-known verse among the fundamentalists, the wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. But in verse 15 and 16 it says, the heathen are sunk down in the pit that they made, in the net which they hid is their own foot taken. The Lord is known by the judgment which he executeth. The wicked is snared in the work of his own hands. And that is a principle we just studied in some detail, that the wicked are snared in that which they design for the righteous. Then he says, the wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. If I were to take that literally, as the fundamentalists do many of these scriptures, then we would have to say that the wicked must be the builders and designers of hell. Now, I've read the first four uses of the word hell in the Old Testament. And let's just see what they said here, and you can see why someone had better do some more explaining about hell than we get from the churches. The first one, we found that the fire in that hell burned up the earth, or would burn up the earth, and all of its increase. In the second one, David, in effect, said he had already experienced the sorrows of hell, and he obviously was still alive. In the third one, it only says that God is deeper than hell, but in the fourth one, it appears that hell is a place the wicked must have built with their own hands. Now let me read something else from quotations from these church descriptions of hell. On page 31, and this is quite a few pages I've skipped, as you've seen. This is from several centuries ago. To punish therefore so great a boldness, the breaking of God's commandments, God therefore has framed a prison in the lowest region of the universe, a very suitable place as the farthest from heaven. Though the place itself is wide enough, the damned will not even have that relief, because they shall be bound up like a faggot and heaped upon one another like unfortunate victims, and this by reason of the great numbers of the damned, as also because the fire itself will be to them like chains and fetters. Besides, God will not concur with anything that can give them any manner of relief. Now, as I read these things out of this book, and I'm going to read some more, some will say, well, Pastor Emery, why don't you read the biblical description of hell and then you show us what it is? Well, first of all, why do not some of the people who believe these things go to the verses of Scripture which describe what they write? Do you read any place in the Scripture about how they're going to be heaped upon one another, and that the fire will be like chains and fetters, and besides, God will not concur with anything that can give them any manner of relief? These things are from that writer, of course. No Scripture references are given. Now turn with me to Genesis 37. And before I read these verses of Scripture, now I should explain that which most of you know, but perhaps some of you do not, and it seems as if most Protestant ministers do not, that the word hell is in the Old Testament 31 times. In each case, it comes from a Hebrew word, Sheol, spelled in English, S-H-E-O-L. But the Hebrew word Sheol is also translated into the English word grave 30 times and into pit 3 times. So, if we want to make a study of Sheol, from which we get the English word hell in the Old Testament, of course we should read some of the passages where Sheol is used and translated something other than hell. In Genesis 37, Joseph has been sold into slavery, put him in the pit, and then Joseph has been sold, verse 29, and Reuben returned unto the pit, and behold, Joseph was not in the pit, and he rent his clothes. And he returned unto his brethren and said, The child is not, and I, whither shall I go? And they took Joseph's coat and killed a kid of the goats and dipped the coat in the blood. And they sent the coat of many colors, and they brought it to their father and said, This have we found, know now whether it be thy son's coat or no. And he knew it and said, It is my son's coat. An evil beast hath devoured him. Joseph is without doubt rent in pieces. So Jacob Israel at this point is convinced that Joseph is dead. He says, Without doubt, Joseph is rent in pieces. And Jacob rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. And all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted, and he said, For I will go down into Sheol unto my son mourning. Thus his father wept for him. In other words, Jacob Israel, the progenitor and father of the Israel people, the man chosen of God to lead the world into righteousness through the preaching of his word, this man said, Joseph, my son, is dead. He must be in Sheol, and I will sorrow and go down to Sheol with him. This is the word translated hell. Turn to Genesis 42, in case you didn't get that. The sons have now gone into Egypt to buy grain from Joseph, and they did not know him. In verse 14, And Joseph said unto them, That is it that I spake unto you, saying, Ye are spies. Hereby ye shall be proved. By the life of Pharaoh ye shall not go forth hence, except your youngest brother come hither. And of course he meant Benjamin, who was his full brother. The rest of these, of course, were all half-brothers. And then he goes on, verse 19, If ye be true men, let one of your brethren be bound in the house of your prison. Go ye, carry corn for the famine of your houses, but bring your youngest brother unto me. So shall your words be verified, and ye shall not die. And they did so. And of course they went home and told Father Jacob that this man down in Egypt insisted that Benjamin be now taken into Egypt in order for them to get the corn and the things that they needed. And we read this in starting in verse 36. And Jacob their father said unto them, Me have ye bereaved of my children. Joseph is not, and Simeon is not. And of course Simeon was kept in Egypt. And ye will take Benjamin away. All these things are against me. And Reuben spake unto his father, saying, Slay my two sons, if I bring him not to thee. Deliver him into my hand, and I will bring him to thee again. And he said, or Jacob said, My son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he is left alone. If mischief befall him by the way in the which ye go, then shall ye bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to Sheol, to the grave. And I must emphasize for people who are new to this that Sheol is the same identical Hebrew word from which we get all of the words hell in the Old Testament. So it's very obvious in both of these that good, godly Jacob expected to go to Sheol when he died, and he already believed that Joseph had died and was in Sheol, the same word translated hell. Now let's read some more about this place, this Sheol, this hell, according to church doctrine. And this is a direct quote, again, from books published several hundred years ago and generally taught or used in the churches in Europe. The fire of hell is kindled by a sulfurous and bituminous matter, which will always burn with an unspeakable fury. The fire in which the damned shall forever be tormented shall burn without ever consuming, torturing them with inconceivable heat in the nature of fire. If a little flame of our fire so much frightens us, how shall we be able to be buried forever in flames whose violence exceeds all imagination? This great pit of hell will be full of fire. Who is there that can doubt that if a whole mountain were thrown into this great surface, that it would melt as a piece of wax? Everyone that is damned will be like a lighted furnace. All that filthy blood will boil in their veins. The infernal fire, then, is an effect of the omnipotency of God injured by sinners. They, the company of the damned, will all be filled with hatred, wishing each other all evil, full of enmity. They will be like thorns, always pricking and tearing one another to pieces, what curses, what furies will those of the damned be? Not a night of some hours, but of a night that will last forever. And he goes on, pain in hell certainly must be infinite and surpass all our thoughts to conceive it. All the years of eternity will pass, and none of our pain will be lessened, not so much as one instant taken from eternity. The unfortunate creatures will not only be tormented for an eternity, but will have eternity itself to torment them. Now that is a description of hell, the place that Jacob, Israel, expected to go when he died. I don't know whether they read the Bible or not. Turn to Genesis 44. The famine is worse in the land, in Egypt. And Judah took Benjamin, and here he's explaining to Joseph about his bringing Benjamin into Egypt. Verse 18, then Judah came near unto him and said, O my lord, let thy servant, I pray thee, speak a word in my lord's ears, and let not thine anger burn against thy servant, for thou art even as Pharaoh. So here Judah is talking to Joseph, and Joseph, of course, is still unknown as to who he really is to the sons of Jacob Israel. Verse 25, he further explains what happened and how he got Jacob to let him bring Benjamin to Egypt. And our father said, go again and buy us a little food. And we said, we cannot go down. If our youngest brother be with us, then will we go down. For we may not see the man's face, meaning Joseph, except our youngest brother be with us. And thy servant my father said unto us, ye know that my wife bare me two sons, and the one went out from me, and I said, surely he is torn in pieces, and I saw him not since. And if ye take this also from me, and mischief befall him, ye shall bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to the grave, to Sheol. Judah is repeating that which Jacob Israel had said to him in explaining why he did not want Benjamin to go. Verse 30, now therefore, when I come to thy servant my father, and the lad be not with us, seeing that his life is bound up in the lad's life, it shall come to pass, when he seeth that the lad is not with us, that he will die. Judah said, if I don't bring Benjamin back, my father, Jacob Israel, will die, and thy servant shall bring down the gray hairs of thy servant our father with sorrow to Sheol, here translated, to the grave. So Judah, who was one of the tribes of Israel, and according to the genealogy of Christ, Christ was born through the Judah line. Judah believed that his father, Jacob Israel, was going to go to Sheol, to hell, when he died. Now let's see something else on this same book. Let me read about this place where Jacob Israel was going to go. Quote, this is a book, Traditional Aspects of Hell. You know what happens when a man salts pork? The salt penetrates by degrees through every nerve and fiber. It enters into the substance of the bones, and yet is the meat in no wise disintegrated, but rather preserved by this process of pickling. Precisely in the same fashion, the fire of hell pierces the marrow, occupies the inwards, and the brain boils therewith in raging smart, and yet suffers neither death nor dissolution. Here is another one. This is more recent, about 200 years ago. Is it not common to say to a child, put your finger in that candle, can you bear it even for 1 minute? How then will you bear hellfire? What will it be to have the whole body plunged into a lake of fire burning with brimstone? Let's go on in Genesis. One, of course, I'm reading from the scripture. The other, I'm reading from the church's description of the place that Jacob Israel expected to go. Genesis 49 and 50. Now here, Jacob Israel is dying. In Genesis 49, we read this starting in verse 28. All these are the 12 tribes of Israel, and this is that their father spake unto them and blessed them. Every one according to his blessing he blessed them. And he charged them and said unto them, I am to be gathered unto my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephraim the Hittite, in the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephraim the Hittite, for a possession of a burying place. There they buried Abraham and Sarah, his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife. And there I buried Leah. The purchase of the field and of the cave that is therein was from the children of Heth. And when Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons, he gathered up his feet into the bed and yielded up the ghost and was gathered unto his people. Now, I know they take that last phrase there and they say, well, that means he went to be with his people in, and some say purgatory, some say a certain compartment of hell, and some say hell and so on. But let's read on and see just what in the world it was Jacob meant when he was giving these instructions to his sons as to what they were to do with him when he died. It goes right on, Genesis 50. And Joseph fell upon his father's face and wept upon him and kissed him. And Joseph commanded his servants, the physicians, to embalm his father, and the physicians embalmed Israel. And 40 days were fulfilled for him, for so are fulfilled the days of those which are embalmed, and the Egyptians mourned for him 70 days. And when the days of his mourning were past, Joseph spake unto the house of Pharaoh, saying, If now I have found grace in your eyes, speak, I pray you, in the ears of Pharaoh, saying, My father made me swear, saying, Lo, I die in my Sheol, in my grave, which I have digged for me in the land of Canaan, there shalt thou bury me. Now therefore let me go up, I pray thee, and bury my father, and I will come again. In other words, Joseph then goes to Pharaoh and said, My father instructed me to bury him in Sheol. Take his body and bury him in Sheol. Now, what was the instruction? Back in verse 29 of the previous chapter, Jacob said, Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephraim the Hittite. Do you mean to tell me that it's possible that the Sheol that Jacob was going to go to when he died was nothing more than a cave that he had purchased for the burying of his body? Yes, my friends, that's what I mean to tell you. Sheol is the grave. That's where this man expected to go. Now let's turn to Webster's again, definition. And I'm reading this because this is 100 years old or a little over. This is Noah Webster's original dictionary published in 1828. That's about 150 years ago. And this is the definitions he gives for hell, or for the word or the meaning of hell. He says it's originating from a Saxon word, hell, helle, and he gives the German, Swedish, Danish, and so on. A deep place, or from the Saxon, Helen, to cover. A deep place, or from the Saxon word Helen, meaning to cover. Then he gives 7 meanings by usage. Number 1, the place or state of punishment for the wicked after death. Number 2, the place of the dead or of souls after death. The lower regions or the grave, called in Hebrew Sheol and by the Greeks Hades. Number 3, the pains of hell, temporal death. The pains of hell, temporal death, or the agonies that dying persons feel or which bring to the brink of the grave. Now just think of that for a moment. We read in the Psalms that David said he had suffered the sorrows of hell. And here Webster says, the pain of hell is the pain of dying. That takes you to what he said in the first one, or the grave. Number 4, the gates of hell, the power and policy of Satan and his instruments. Number 5, the infernal powers. Number 6, the place at a running play to which are carried those who are caught. And number 7, a place into which a tailor throws his shreds. There are 7 meanings by usage. And all of these have some background in the scripture, but the people who translated the King James obviously used a Saxon word which Noah Webster, 150 years ago, said means a deep place or to cover. And he has that word over here on the next, or the previous page, helling, from hell, the covering of the roof of a building, parentheses, not used in the United States. In other words, this is a Saxon word from Europe, hell or helling means to cover up or to put in a pit. The original word has no meaning or connotation of pain or torture or punishment at all. Now let me read from this little book again about this hell. He says on another page here, there's so much to read, I don't know what to read. I think I'll read this one, and then we're going to get into this next week, God willing. This is titled, I think this author put the title in, A Joyful Show. But then the quote is actually from a writing of about 100 years ago. The view of the misery of the damned will double the ardor of the love and gratitude of the saints in heaven. I should comment, he's talking about the rich man and Lazarus, where you can see between hell and heaven. The view of the misery of the damned will double the ardor of the love and gratitude of the saints in heaven. The sight of hell torments will exalt the happiness of the saints forever. It will not only make them more sensible of the greatness and freeness of the grace of God in their happiness, but it will really make their happiness the greater, as it will make them more sensible of their own happiness. It will give them a more lively relish of it. It will make them prize it the more. When they see others who are of the same nature and born under the same circumstances plunged in such misery, and they so distinguished, oh, it will make them sensible how happy they are. A sense of the opposite misery in all cases greatly increases the relish of any joy or pleasure. Every time they look upon the damned, it will excite in them a lively and admiring sense of the grace of God in making them so to differ. Now that is a Protestant description of heaven, as you guessed, and what a great bliss it would be, because they would be able to look down and see the miseries of hell. Let's turn to 2 Samuel 3. And I am now reading all of the first uses of the word grave in the Old Testament, still coming from that same identical Hebrew word sheol, from which hell is translated in every case. 2 Samuel 3, David here is burying Abner, and I read this starting in verse 31. And David said to Joab and to all the people that were with him, rend your clothes and gird you with sackcloth and mourn before Abner, and King David himself followed the bier. And they buried Abner in Hebron, and the king lifted up his voice and wept at the sheol of Abner, and all the people wept. So Abner was buried in Sheol, and these people wept at the sheol, the grave of Abner. What was it? Was it a place of torment? No, it was a hole in the ground. It was a grave. Here is another further description, and this one is very enlightening, and you think with me. This is the last one I'll read out of this book today. Before I read it, I should point out, or I should show you, this booklet, A Message from Hell to You. And God willing, I'm going to read a little bit of this next week and get into the story of the rich man and Lazarus, because this supposedly is a letter from hell by the rich man writing to you, telling you what's going on down there. And in the back of this book, the publisher writes, quote, in 1971, we had 1 million copies printed in South Korea, 150,000 in Japanese, 50,000 in Chinese, and 850,000 in the Korean language. And then they said their missionary there wrote that he had put one in the hand of every military person in all branches of the South Korean military. And then he tells about what they're doing with this tract, A Message from Hell to You. Now I want to read you something by a man apparently very high up in the church. The name of this man was Thomas Burnett. In his De Statu Mortuorum, argues with considerable support from the ancient fathers against the endlessness of hell torture. In other words, he argues that it does not go on forever and ever. But, says he in Latin, quote, whatever you determine within yourself about the eternity of punishment, you certainly ought to preach the common doctrine of hellfire to the people, especially to those of the lower rank. In other words, this high church official said it is possible that the torment does not last forever, but whatever you personally decide about it, it is better that you preach the common church doctrine on hell to the masses or to the people, especially to those of the lower rank. And then he added, quote, whoever shall translate this sentiment into the mother tongue, I shall think it was done with an evil design and a bad purpose. In other words, leave this in Latin so the people will not know what I am saying, because at that time only the priests and the ministers were trained in the use of Latin. So way back several hundred years ago, this high church official said, I don't care what you believed about the eternal torments of the damned, but you should preach it to the common people. Let's turn to Jeremiah 19, and I think we'll close there for this time. Jeremiah 19, verses 3 and 4. Here God is rebuking Israel for their sin and iniquity. And say, hear ye the word of the Lord, O kings of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. Behold, I will bring evil upon this place, the which whosoever heareth, his ears shall tingle. Because they have forsaken me, and have estranged this place, and have burned incense in it unto other gods, whom neither they nor their fathers have known, nor the kings of Judah, and have filled this place with the blood of the innocents. And how did they do that? Verse 5. They have built also the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings unto Baal, which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind. In other words, these Judah people had burnt their sons in fire as an offering to God. God accuses them of doing that and says he's going to bring destruction on their whole nation because of it. And yet today the church has turned right around and tell us that God himself is going to burn most of his sons, his children, in fire, not just to kill them, but forever and ever and ever. God said because of the fact they burned their sons in fire, verse 6, therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that this place shall no more be called Tophet, nor the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. And I will make void the council of Judah and Jerusalem in this place, and I will cause them to fall by the sword before their enemies, and by the hands of them that seek their lives, and their carcass will I give to be meat for the fowls of the heaven and for the beasts of the earth. And I will make this city desolate and an hissing. Every one that passeth thereby shall be astonished and hiss because of all the plagues thereof. Why? Because they burned their sons and daughters in fire. And yet today we turn right around and we say, oh, this God who condemned Judah for burning their sons in fire is going to burn most of his sons forever and ever and ever. Let me reread part of that definition by Noah Webster of the word blasphemy. He quotes Linwood, blasphemy is an injury offered to God by denying that which is due and belonging to him, or attributing to him that which is not agreeable to his nature. God said the burning of sons in fire was not commanded by him, neither came it into my mind.